And I don't know. Okay.
Oh, he just moved, but okay. kind of like doing a robot thing.
Stop talking so we can do the intro. All right. Hello and welcome to Just Animals Podcast. I'm Elle, and with me as always is my dad, aka Guy.
Hi there, Pod World.
Okay. And unfortunately, Sam the zookeeper cannot be with us tonight. She is back in school and school has gotten a little hectic. Although we do have a phenomenal guest today. We have Shay from Advanced Wildlife coming in live all the way from Maui, Hawaii, who we are very excited to have on the show.
Wait a minute. So you got to go. Hold on. Aloha.
No, we're not going to do all that. He's from Pomona. We're not doing all that.
He's from Pasadena. Oh, he's from Pomona. Yeah. Pasadena. As if.
Yeah. Wait, Pomona or Pasadena? Sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which Pasadena. One? Okay, sorry. Excuse me. He's from Pasadena. So Pasadena, the other P town.
The Rose Bowl.
Yeah, yep. He's from the Rose Bowl. So you don't get an aloha. No, I'm just kidding.
He can still get an aloha. How long you been on Maui now, Shay?
I've been here 7 years now.
So, oh, okay.
I think he's qualified almost.
All right. Yeah. Well, 7 years. Yeah. You can get an aloha now. Yeah. All right. So anyways, Shay from Advanced Wildlife. Go ahead. Tell our listeners who you are, what you do, and we'll get into it.
Yeah. So I'm a wildlife biologist on Maui. I grew up in Pasadena. Wanted to see what seasons are like. So I went to school in Colorado, Boulder. I studied biology and environmental studies, graduated from there. Worked for the Forest Service for a while in Northern California. Lesson, and then I got an AmeriCorps internship with the Seabird Project on Maui. So I was an intern there, got hired on full-time. The birds we worked with are the wedge-tailed shearwater, so they can dive 200 feet underwater and sleep and fly at the same time. And a big part of our job, these birds use the moon and stars to navigate, so bright lights really confuse them. So they end up like circling the lights and kind of getting exhausted and landing all over the island. So our job was to pick them up and make sure they're okay and release them back to sea. But these birds, they burrow on the beach, and a lot of times people saw the holes and thought it was like rats or mongoose and put trash in them. So once they found out it was seabirds, they got really excited and wanted to help. So I realized that education was most important, and I've always loved to draw. So I started my own business, and I created my own line of educational coloring books. So I did all the illustrations and self-published the books myself. I've been doing it full-time for about almost 5 years now. So I have 21 different books, ranging from like Hawaiian species, the sharks and rays, marine mammals, like Pacific Northwest, North America. Yeah, I just realized that people want to help, but you can't protect you don't know exists, and everybody needs to know about all their local species. So my goal is to help educate and inspire the next generation of biologists and conservationists and entrepreneurs. So
I'm sorry, turn off your phone, please.
Okay, I'm sorry. I don't know why that's making noise here. Sorry.
Sorry, that is phenomenal. So you came up with all like the designs in your coloring, adult coloring books? Or
yeah.
That is fantastic. Yeah. So are you an art minor or just an artist on the side?
Just always kind of just love drawing. So it's always just kind of like, I always grew up, it was between art and wildlife. So it was always my two passions.
And you were able to successfully combine them. That's so fantastic, because you always hear people being like, I'm interested in X and Y, but I ended up doing Z because X and Y weren't really working out. Mm-hmm. But that's fantastic. You were able to combine those two and also educate others at the same time. Mm-hmm. So can you tell us a little bit more about these birds that they can sleep while they fly and then also burrow in the ground? I mean, that's insane. That all just sounds insane to me personally.
Yeah. So the wedge-tailed shearwater, so they're known as like the moaning petrel. They actually sound like crying babies. It's kind of funny. So a lot of times people, like, they're not used to it. So they'll hear the cry and think it's a baby, and they'll call the police, report like a baby on the beach, and do a whole search and rescue. And then the bird like hops out, and the Hawaiians used to tell their children to be good or else they're going to go on the beach with all the other crying babies. So it's pretty funny. But
are these birds on Maui?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, they're all over the island.
Uh-huh. Oh, okay. So, like, which...
They kind of look like a seagull. They look like a mini seagull.
Would they
seagull.
Be down, like, Wailea, McKenna area? Or, you know,
yeah.
What kind of...
Yeah, the three colonies on Maui's at Camp 3, Hokipa, and the Pili, like, area, or, like, Hawea. Okay. Yeah. So, that's the largest.
Do they have any protection right now, you know, in terms of... the wildlife, what do they call the Hawaii wildlife fishing game? I don't know what they call it.
Yeah, so the Seabird Project's been really good about doing like predator control. There was like trapping as well, because the biggest problem, so unfortunately, Hawaii is the extinction capital of the world. It's because the only native mammals here are the monk seal and the bats. So all these animals have evolved for millions of years without any predators, also known as like feral cats, mongoose, rats. So there's a lot of, and dogs as well. So they're a really big problem for all these.
What about those roosters that are running around all over the place? And chickens.
Yeah, and not as much. But yeah, those chickens are everywhere. So they do a really good job about removing a lot of the invasive plants and predator control as well. Just trying to, because there was 1 year, I think we were banning the birds or the chicks. So I think we counted around 100 and a little over 100 chicks. And then the next year, the following year, we went and there was maybe three. Just because there was a giant cat colony that just was right next to the bird. So yeah, they just have no defense mechanisms and they're just burrowing on the bird, on the ground. And I've got into a couple of conversations with people who feed these cat colonies, and it's just kind of tough trying to convince them. They're like, oh no, like my cats are really well fed, they wouldn't hurt any birds, but they just kind of, we have them on video and they just kind of kill for fun. And it was just like,
They're natural. Yeah, they just kill for fun. Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. Exactly. Well,
cats in general are responsible for a gajillion of bird and little lizard species going extinct, even on the mainland. So I think that's a big thing to mention. We've touched on that briefly, but just like, keep, if you have a pet cat, just keep it inside. And then if they're feral cats, like, you know, take them to a shelter if you can, or, you know, let someone know that can come trap them up and take them to a shelter. But cats really don't need to be outside.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's, because when the islands are first being formed, it's just all lava rock. So the seabirds are the ones that brought all the nutrients from the ocean to the land for everything to start growing. So from the beaches all the way up to Haleakala, or like mountaintops, it's just all seabirds, the whole island. So they play a really vital role, and they just, they haven't had to deal with any predators. So this is all really
So are they, the seabirds, they don't go up to Haleakala, do they?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's the Hawaiian petrels up there, which is an endangered seabird. So
are they in better shape up there, or are there still cats up there too?
There's cats up there too.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. What are they doing up there at 8,000 feet?
Even up to 10,000 feet at the observatory.
No kidding. They're all the way up at the observatory? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that was big part of our job too. We were on Kaiki Nui, so it's on the south sides, and we would go from 10,000 feet to 8,000 feet, just trying to do trapping for like mongoose, feral cats, rats. They're able to survive up there, and there's not really any winters, and they don't have any predators.
That's insane. I mean, what is there to eat up at 10,000 feet? I mean, I guess those birds, but I mean, like, and I guess the rats, but that's, I mean, to me, it's just like 10,000 feet. What are you getting up there? Because, I mean, we've all been up there. Haleakala is pretty desolate the higher you go up. You know, it doesn't really seem like there's much going on up there, but obviously there's enough to sustain that type of life, which is insane.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
So are you able to trap the cats, and what do you do with them? Do they get euthanized? Do they get like made to cat food? Or
ship them back to the mainland?
Shipping back to the main.
So we're using traps, or like kill traps. So, it being the traps, we haven't crossed any live ones.
Is that a federal project or a state project that you're working on?
Something like state and university.
Oh, okay. They're funding that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that was the Seabird project. So
as far as cats and dogs go, do they like harass, I mean, in addition to humans, obviously, will they harass the monk seals and the sea turtles on the island, or will they go after them? Is that a problem
too? Another big problem is for the monk seals, toxoplasmosis from the cats will get washed into the ocean. So it's a huge problem for the monk seals as well. So it's kind of bad all around with these introduced species.
Basically, eradicate cats. You need to have a cat holocaust. Where's
the toxoplasmosis coming from?
The cats.
From their urine?
Yeah, like feces. So get washed into the ocean.
Yeah, cats are pretty dirty. I mean, we know someone, they got scratched by a cat and then they got blood poisoning from it. I mean,
yeah.
Yeah. So you guys need to just eradicate all cats.
I didn't know we
had
to be mad at cats, but it looks like...
we got to hate, cats now.
I just did a cat book, and it's not the cat's fault. The cat's just being a cat, but it's kind of these feral cats. I think it's kind of hard sometimes for people to see the difference between a feral cat and like a pet cat or like an indoor cat. So best advice I have is like keep the cats inside. And then also feeding feral cats or like doing trap and neutering doesn't work because you have to get pretty much like 89% of the population for it to actually work, which is really hard and possible to do. So and then also having like the collars and the bells doesn't really work either because the animals haven't really associate that with like a predator. So like bright colors and bells, they don't associate that with predators, so that doesn't really work either, like people think it does.
Oh, okay. Yikes.
Yeah.
So they don't associate the bell sound with danger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, how is the population doing? Are you working on getting the cats under control, or do these cats, are they feral cats,
yeah,
or do they belong to some?
He's trying to explain the difference because, okay, so here's the thing. I live in a city. I'm sure we've all seen those city feral cats. They are no joke. They are not domestic animals. They are just these wild heathen savages that like don't know how to act basically and will mess you up.
Yeah.
they're not like these, oh, cute little house kitty. It's like,
no, they're jungle cats.
They are. They're completely there. I mean, feral is the only way to describe them because they will destroy your life.
Yeah.
If they need to.
Yeah. And it's, it's been pretty tough, and it's not that great of a life for the feral cats either. They don't really end up living too long just because of they're usually like starving and have like maybe
right.
So so feeding them isn't always the best idea either, just because it keeps that population going and just is a really hard life for them as well.
Right. I mean, you see a dead one every now and then because it got hit. Or, I mean, there was one outside of our garage and it was like dragging one of its legs. And I went to go get a box to try to, you know, scoop him up and take him to a shelter. But of course, by the time I got back down there to him, he was gone. And then I saw him one more time and then I haven't seen him since. And he was definitely a feral cat. But that's a good point, too, that feral cats, it's not an easy life for them either. So they really just don't need to be out there between killing animals and then just having
so it's kind of
crap life.
Yeah, and like I said, it's not the cat's fault. The cat's just been a cat,
right,
but it
of
should,
course.
Yeah, it's just not feeding feral cats or feeding just wild animals in general.
Exactly. So, can you find monk seals on Maui? Do they come ashore?
They do. More in the north. There's a lot more in the northwestern islands and Kauai.
Okay.
There's only very few sightings here. It's kind of tough. They're one of the most endangered marine mammals in the world. So,
right.
I've never seen one.
Yeah. So there's only...
We did see... I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, no. So there's only about 1,200, around 1,200. Amongst
That's
where
it?
Did we, where did we go to that beach where we saw all those giant turtles sitting out there on
that
the
was
beach?
That was north by the...
By the lifeguard station over there.
That was up north by the... To the... If you went... east of the airport.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Hoakipa, actually. Mm-hmm. Paia, yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There were some giant turtles that are just sitting on the beach, and you can see them, you know, trudging in the water, trying to get to the water. And,
yeah, they like to rest there.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably because people don't mess with them there.
And
I
you know
like
what?
To rest there
it
too.
Says don't go beyond this point, and stupid people are still going over beyond that point. They're dumb as the cat.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. That's been a really big issue too with just the influx of like tourism or just people in general. They just don't really respect the wildlife. They'll try to say like stay 50 feet away, but there's videos going viral of people like touching the monk seals or monk
yes.
seals or messing with the turtles and just trying to like get in their face to take pictures. So it's a really big issue. Just trying to disrespect the wildlife.
So, Shay, I have seen turtles that have a number on their shell. Have you ever seen that?
I have, yeah. But
so who's
tracking them,
yeah.
I'm not too familiar. I think it would probably be like the Hawaii Wildlife Fund, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
Could that be a federal thing too?
Honestly, I'm not too sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what he's. I mean, so have we seen any? I don't think we've seen any banded ones.
I've only seen like turtles that had a number on their shell. So Shay, tell us about your website. Do you sell your wares on the web?
I do. Yeah. So I have all the books on my website, like advancedwildlifeeducation.org.
Hold on.
Show us a picture from one of your books.
Yeah.
Wildlife.
Feel kind of like a pervert being like, show us.
Education. Okay, let's see.
Maybe if
advancedwildlifeeeducation.org.
Let's see.
He's showing us his. Okay.
Sorry. I think that.
I'm on the website.
Does that work? Can you see that or is it back? Backwards. It's just,
what does
it's
AWE just, stand for?
Advancedwildlifeeducation.org.
Oh, hello.
Okay. Use your brain, please.
I'm just only half a beat behind. Let's see what.
Show us one of your drawings.
Yeah. So, yeah, like I said, I have.
Oh, he's got the sea turtle.
21 different books.
Well, I guess we'll be collecting all 21 at some point. Thank you.
Well, we're getting the turtle one first.
Yeah. So here is the turtle.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
Mm-hmm. So all the books, they have like the Hawaiian name and information, diet, status in the books as well.
And you drew that? My gosh, that is.
Yeah.
Jeez Louise. Okay.
Yeah. So I have, all the books have, you know, fun facts, diet, status. I put a whole bunch of different graphs in there too. So there's like some people are always scared about sharks. So in the U.S., only one person is killed a year by sharks compared to 20 by cows, 20 by dogs, 52 by deer, most by hornets and wasps, and how people can help on a personal level, like sustainable versus non-sustainable fishing.
Oh, that's fantastic. See, that's
photographs so you can see what they look like.
Oh, that is so great.
And then during the lockdown, I even developed an app too so that people can do it on their phone as well.
Cool.
So that's always been a project I wanted to do, but just never really had the time until then.
Of course.
You got your book in a lot of places. You got the book at the Maui Ocean Center, the park. That's great, man.
Yeah.
We're actually going to be back on Maui in January. We would love, we would love to connect with you if we can, you know, help. Maybe help you do field research or do anything cool. We'd love to tag along if that's okay.
Yeah.
Well, also we can see him at the Maui.
I do the Maui College swap meet on Saturdays, the craft fair on Sundays, and then I'm in Kanapali 2 days out of the week. So Mondays and Fridays, I'm at the West in KOR.
So you got, are your books printed on Maui or is it printed on mainland shipped to Maui? In the Hawaii.
There isn't. There's not much manufacturing here, so it's kind of tough. But no, I get them printed in Asia and then I'm shipped over.
So, you must have had to hustle to get those outlets to get your book. I mean, was that a pain in the neck for you?
Yeah. I have them in about 65 different store locations now. When I first started, I did a whole, I would just walk into just all these different stores constantly with my books and stuff like that. I even did a road trip with my dad. We went from San Diego all the way to Port Angeles, Washington with the book. So we stopped at like 120 different store locations and just walking in cold, and he was driving. I was just like looking up places on the way. It was kind of tough because the people that I needed to talk to weren't always there, but I would end up selling to like employees or people in line that heard my pitch and just wanted some books right there. So,
awesome.
I'm glad to see that the aquarium got you and the Whale Foundation and
yes.
I'm trying to think of.
Yes, good. List off everyone that he. Okay, I'm sure he knows who has his books.
That's great.
So it's like Haleakala National Park.
On
the National Park on Big Island, Native Intelligence, Mana Foods, Down to Earth, Trilogy, Pacific Whale Foundation.
That's so fantastic, though, because I've got some of those like adult coloring books or whatever, and they're like animal ones. But I think I love how yours actually has some little facts about the animal on the side, so you can actually learn more about it if you would like to. I think that's fantastic. I mean, you've really, I think, hit struck gold here with this idea. As someone who also loves art and animals, it's just phenomenal. What other animals have you studied, or what other projects have you worked on?
Like I said, I pretty much worked with the seabird project as soon as I got out of school. I was with the Alaska National Forest Ecology team up in Susanville, Northern California, for a season after graduation. And then I got my internship out here, and I've been out here since. So I was with the seabird project for 3.5 years, and then been doing this full time for about 4 years now.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
Okay. So what would you say your favorite animal is? If you could pick one, if you had to pick one, you could pick two. I'll go easy on it. You can pick two.
Definitely be the seabirds that I worked with, the wedge-tailed shearwaters, just because they're so goofy and just like seabirds are so funny. They just cry. They sound like crying babies. And then unlike other birds, they can't just take off, like flap their wings and take off. They need the wind to open up their wings. So they're just, they're just pretty awkward and goofy birds. So they're really cool.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Oh, the turtle one sold out.
Yeah, so I won't have those for about another month.
All right, well, we'll keep one for us when we come see you at the fair.
Yeah. So and then I also go to schools and give presentations to the kids as well. So I kind of go in to talk to them.
Oh, I'm sure they love that.
So I go in there to talk to them about like all the different native species. I'm like, a humpback whale is the same weight as like 16 Tacoma trucks, or parrotfish can poop out like
the Tacoma truck. There you go.
Right? I know. It's relatable. So I talk to them about the different native species, and then as well as the invasive species as well. So like the minor birds, they're originally introduced in the 1800s. They're originally from India. The red-crested cardinals originally from Brazil. Cattle egrets were brought in the 60s from Florida. And then
I'm sorry, I have a question for you. I noticed you did a book on dinosaurs. Sorry about that. And I want to know if you are familiar with the cassowary, which is like a modern velociraptor. That bird is badass. Have you ever heard of a cassowary?
Which one?
The cassowary, that giant ass emu looking bird in northern it has claws Australia and like Papua New Guinea.
Oh, I haven't. No,
you need to.
You would. I feel like if you saw a picture, you would recognize. It's one of those things. Just like you know what it is, you just don't know the name.
Yeah, you said the emu.
It's similar.
Okay, I did post about that one. Yeah,
has like the blue face and the like, big kind of horn on its head.
Yeah.
Has the same. It's a velociraptor.
Yeah.
Basically. Okay. Yeah, velociraptor.
And,
yes.
That. And its foot can go through a door. Its claws can it can put it through a door.
Right. Yeah.
And those birds. Yeah, they're just.
Yes, very, very. So I was shocked to learn this when we first spoke. All the geckos and lizards on the islands are all non-native, correct?
Yeah, because originally
isn't that shocking?
In order to get here in the first place, you'd have to be flying or swimming. So the Madagascar day dust gecko that was introduced by, I think it was a UH student in Manoa. He had a couple and he like released them, or it's kind of. Yeah, I was looking more into the wallabies because there's a small population of wallabies on Oahu. So
yeah, did you know that?
No, where?
On Oahu, there's just a small population, and they're thriving, aren't they?
I think last time they said there was maybe they would estimate like 40, so it's not like a huge population, but there was
wallabies.
Yeah, there was a private zoo, early 1900s. I think it was attacked by dogs. It said, and there's three of them. The youngest got killed, but the two adults escaped, and then from there they kind of started a population.
I mean, but still, 40 wallabies on Oahu, I feel like it's also nothing to scoff at. You know, you've got 40 wallabies somewhere that they shouldn't be on a small island, and they're somehow surviving. So what that means, if they're from the same breeding pair, they've got like no genetic diversity. So if some like illness were to come along, would they all be wiped out then?
Sure. I mean, if there's that many now, maybe there's more genetic diversity, but that's kind of something. Yeah, there's not too much research on that, or nobody's really tracking that one, because I guess they're low threat because they eat more like invasive species and they're vegetarian.
Oh, okay. So it's kind of working out. An introduced species is
on the list, but they know that they're there. And then I was also looking into the poisonous dart frogs, like I was saying. Those like green and black dart frogs are there as well. So those are introduced to take care of like agricultural pests.
So the gecko and the lizard are not native. I mean, I get, you said it has
I know, flies. I was shocked. That was, yeah. He shocked me too with that one. I was like, no way. Gecko
was I mean.
One of the originals, the one of the OGs.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, so they came by canoe or ship. And then in the 60s, there was a pet store owner on Oahu, and he shipped in a bunch of Jackson chameleons from Kenya. So they look kind of sick. Uh-huh. So they look kind of sick, and then he put them in his backyard, hoping to get them later, and then they just kind of released from there. And from that one shipment, they spread to the islands, the other islands. So now there's like, you see them all the time up country on like Maui.
But they eat bugs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, but bugs are probably always there.
It's just like,
well, unless they flew in.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. You've bat colonies. Are they microbats or fruit bats on the islands? Or both?
I know it's a hoary bat. Not too sure what their diet is.
And so they're native.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the hoary bat, Hawaiian hoary bat, and the Hawaiian monk seal.
Okay. Okay, those are the... Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay. Interesting. So, and there isn't rabies on the islands, correct?
No, they do. They're pretty strict about that. So any pets that come in, they have to go through like a quarantine.
Right. Okay. Well, I mean, at least you guys have been able to keep out rabies. I mean, it seems like everything else kind of snuck in, but at least there's no rabies.
Yeah. So it's pretty tough. There's constantly species and plant invasive plants or animals that are constantly being introduced all the time. So it's kind of, really, that's why it's extinction capital. It's just really tough for all these animals to adapt fast enough with all these species.
Isn't there a bird up on Haleakala that's endangered?
I think everything on the island is endangered. No,
but there's something that was up there that there are signs up there that talk about.
The nene?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, the Hawaiian goose. So that one's the state bird.
That's the state bird. It is. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't fly, I don't think, does it?
It does.
Uh-huh. It does fly.
Yeah. So it was the Canada goose that came over and then became its own species.
Yeah. Oh, no kidding.
You have them Canadian invaders there too?
Well, they're
all over here.
So they evolved. So they split up. So then that's what turned into the nene. So their legs are a lot longer. And a kind of goose for like walking on lava.
Okay. So how did those Canadian geese get there? Did somebody transport them?
No, they flew here.
Shut up. No way.
Yeah. So it's kind of crazy. That's like the... And there's also like the golden plover, which is a migratory bird. So they do a nonstop trip here from Alaska.
What?
Yeah. They're not even...
How many miles is that?
That's like 3,000 miles.
How do they do that?
A 3,000 mile trip for a teeny tiny bird?
Yeah.
I believe you, but I'm like, no way.
Yeah. No, they're really cool. So you got to check them out.
Yeah, we will. What is this bird called?
It's a golden plover, or the Hawaiian name is a kolea.
So do they come down in like the wintertime then? They come down to...
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so that one's a migratory.
I mean, I know Alaska's not... Oh, it is a teeny, teeny bird.
What is it called?
The golden plover or the kolea.
Golden G-O-L-D-E-N plover?
So do you know anything about the humpback whale migration? I mean, it kind of seems like... They're kind of always there, but they're definitely, you know, peak times where there's more than usual.
So they're here.
No, they're not always there, I don't think.
It seems like they're kind of always there.
They're here not from, a lot, though. November to about March.
When we were just there, I didn't hear any whales. I listened in the
water. No one cares about what you heard and didn't hear. Not everyone gets to go to Hawaii.
I have ultrasonic hearing. Yeah.
Yeah. And then are there leather... Okay, give us a rundown of all the turtle species. There's green sea turtle and like the leatherback ones, right?
So there's the green turtle, which is most common. And then there's the endangered hawksbill.
Ah, okay. And what is the difference?
Hawksbill has other different species. So the hawksbill's endangered. That's the one that they kind of use their shell for like jewelry...
Ooh.
Yeah. Eek. So it's a really big problem for them. So they're endangered as well. So they're both endangered, the green turtle and the hawksbill. But
are you involved with any turtle egg hatching? I know there's a pond over by Kihei, you know, as you're going towards the aquarium. There's a pond there, I think, that where it's a turtle nesting ground. Are you involved at all with turtle, you know, trying to...
You and these turtles.
Trying to make them... well, they're an incredible animal. I mean, mm-hmm. you think they've done it for 200 years, and I just see people touching them or harassing them bothers the shit out of me, but I don't know. How is the turtle species? Are they...
The turtles are doing...
Maintaining?
They're doing better.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I'll bet you the fact that COVID helped them out a lot because not too many people around there screwing around with them. So, like, you know, they can eat, they can do what they do.
Definitely needed that break. The green turtles have been doing a lot better.
Okay, so what is that thing called, Eliana, where they say, you know, endangered and...
The ICUN.
Yeah, ICUN. You're familiar with that?
Yeah.
Shane?
Yeah.
So what is this? What is the status
still,
of those?
They're still endangered.
Oh, still endangered.
Yeah.
Okay, so there isn't anybody that's allowed to hunt those turtles right now, right? I mean, they're federally protected?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. So that's why, they try to have people stay away from them and keep like that.
So
that's the Hawaii Wildlife Fund that deals with them and trying to, like, I hope you try to keep people away from.
Uh-oh, I'll be right back. Yeah, I'll be right back.
Okay, so I have a question. Uh-huh. And of course, it just escaped my memory. God damn it. Okay, but anyway, so back to these seabirds thing. So they need wind. You're saying they need wind to, like, open up their wings to get going so they can't just kind of... Right, so they can't just, you know, like a robin just, you know, you're topping on the ground and then it just is up in the air. So will they, like, orient themselves to catch the...
So they'll usually kind of open up their wings and then the wind will just take them off.
No kidding. Okay, so what about when they're on sea? And is that for, like, the albatross as well? They need wind to get going?
Yeah, so all the seabirds are similar in that way.
Okay. Okay, interesting. So, are they at all related to, like, the booby?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the seabirds. Uh-huh.
Okay, that is so cool. Okay.
Yeah.
That is
so sorry. About
yeah,
that.
So it's more. So then, what about there's the red-footed booby and the brown booby?
No kidding. Mm-hmm. Are they also invasive though?
No. No.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You hear that, Dad? The red booby and brown-footed booby are on Hawaii.
How'd they get there?
Flying.
Flying?
how does the birds get anywhere?
Where are they walking. In Maui? Are they in Maui?
They're more in the northern northwestern islands, so they're around Kauai. There's like little islets that they might be on. Same with the Eva or the frigate birds. You'll see those ones around the white-tailed tropic birds.
So, like, would Kauai have them?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Interesting. Okay.
So Jay, what is do you have another book on in the works?
Yeah. Well, I just finished Fish of the Pacific, and then I did do one on wildcats. Next one, I might be doing with the plan on doing it on seabirds, probably the seabirds, and maybe reptiles will be the next one.
Fish of the Pacific. Well, let me tell you my Fish of the Pacific story.
Okay, no one cares. Jesus, you can tell him to shut up, Shay. This is fine.
Shay,
it's not funny. It's I don't know how you're still harping on this.
We had a fish card. We were getting ready to snorkel in by Wailea. One of those plastic fish cards. You know, they tell you what you're looking at and things like that. My son was very young. He's now 31, and he dropped the card, and I went down to get it. And it disappeared like into some special vortex. I don't know where it is.
Good. Yeah. Tell everyone about how you littered in the ocean. That's fantastic.
I immediately went to pick it up and it disappeared. Like it got sucked. It might be in China now. Who knows?
Yeah.
But it's just so weird that fish card, it was less than a second because as soon as it went down, I went to get it and it wasn't there. So if you ever see a fish card in the water, Fuck it out. That's mine.
Yeah. Pretty quiet mark in it.
Yeah. But I can tell you when we were there in Hawaii in August, the reefs looked better. You know, I think that why don't they – let me ask you a question. This is a little bit off out of your wheelhouse, but there are chemicals in the sunscreen that are bad for the reefs. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure which ones those are. Why can't we outlaw those chemicals here in the United States as dangerous? Does you know what I'm saying? Is somebody – can somebody –
I think they did do a ban. It just took forever to take effect. But they did put a ban on like reef – on getting rid of those on like reef unfriendly sunscreens.
But then you also have to phase them out too, because I mean a bunch of sunscreens have already been in production.
Yeah.
So I'm sure it's like by this year, you know, can't have any more.
The other thing is when you have foreign tourists coming in, they may not abide by what we do here and bring that stuff in anyway.
Yeah.
But at least if we can get all the Americans to not put that stuff on. Is zinc oxide harmful to the reefs, Shay? Do you know?
I'm not too sure about that one.
Okay, because that is probably the best and least problematic of any sunscreen. I don't know how it impacts the reefs, but I don't think it's one of those reef unfriendly chemicals. Let me see if I can Google that quickly.
Yeah, I was at the beach the other day, and just one lady just like walked in, and it's just like looks like a giant oil spill from her body, just like.
Oh, I know. That's the other thing too. Like, people like they put on sunscreen, then they immediately go in the water. It's like, okay, time out. That's not how it works. You just washed all of it off.
Yeah, it was just like one person.
And I was having.
It's just like all the people that go in the water.
No, but you're exactly right though, because I was having to get on my husband about that. I'd spray him, then it'd be like, where are you going? Because I'm going in the water. I'm like, no, you need to sit for like 10 or 15 minutes to actually let the sunscreen soak into your skin, because otherwise you're just going to go in the water. And we had the reef safe.
Just put the sunscreen on when you come out.
But, okay, quiet.
Oh, you see here what it says? Avoid spray-on sunscreens and use safer mineral-based sunscreens like zinc oxide. That's what I was telling you, or titanium oxide.
Okay, yes. Thank you, Bill Nye. Thank you,
Look
Bill Nye.
Look for marine safe icon on the – yeah, it's a big problem. The reefs are, you know, they've been around for thousands of years, and they can get destroyed real fast.
Yes, there's a big problem with that, and the people like stepping on the coral as well.
Yes. Well, maybe that would be a book for you to do, to just go snorkeling and see all those beautiful pieces of coral, and that might be another book, right?
Yeah.
Coral Reef?
Oh, yeah, good. Tell the author what to do next. That's fantastic. Yeah.
No, I'm just planting a seed, you ding dong. Oxybenzone is the bad stuff.
So I have
it disrupts coral.
Kind of just little tips too on like how people can help. So that's in there too, about like not stepping on the reefs and using reef sunscreen and waiting. But it's the Makai, or the Hawaiian ocean species, covers a lot of different like Hawaiian fish as well. But that's the one I'm sold out of right now.
So speaking of, since you did Hawaii, wait, have you done Hawaiian? You've done Hawaiian species. Okay, some sharks. Give us some example of some sharks in the area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so tiger sharks, white tip.
Oh.
Every once in a while, there'll be a whale shark off of Molokini, which is
no
cool.
Kidding.
Yeah.
So one time we were up in Lahaina. You know where the, what is that place called? Cheeseburger in Paradise. There's a little bridge right over there by the beach. And they were telling people not to go in the water, because I think when the fish boats come back in, they throw the junk in the water, which brings the shark. Not junk, you know.
Yeah,
fish parts.
Like in the water.
Exactly. So they said, don't go in the water over there, because it was
no,
the first
we were
time-
in the water.
Yeah.
We were in the water in Wailea.
No, so we were up there. It was us and a couple other family friends and their kids. We were down, you know, on the little beach playing right underneath, you know, the restaurant. And then all of a sudden, you know, some waiter comes and tells our parents, like, get them out of the water. Like, there's going to be sharks there. And so then they, like, came running down after us. They're like, get out of the water. There's sharks. And then actually, sure as shit, there was a shark just kind of swimming along the coastline. It was a little creepy and unnerving. Yeah. I mean, it was cool, but it's just like, oh, that's also very close to land. And thank God we were in like our clothes. We weren't actually trying to go swimming, but that could have been very bad very quickly for everybody.
Right. Yeah. They say like, don't go out in murky water. Don't wear jewelry. Like right. A reflection attracts them.
Right.
Yeah. Don't go out like 6 p.m. to 6 a.m.
Right.
What you have porpoises, right? They're hanging out around the island?
The spinner dolphins.
Is that seasonal or is that
no,
all year
here.
Round?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Do they have the long nose or they don't have the long nose spinner dolphin? Let's see. I don't know what
they do. Are. Yeah, they're over by Lanai, kind of. You'll see them more on like the west side. I saw a pod like last week. Just kind of swimming around.
Spinning. Oh, yeah, they do have the long nose. Yeah. So I don't know if you've ever been on a boat at night, but at least in California, they have these bioluminescent creatures in the water. I don't know what they're called. You probably do. And then when the
That's
dolphin...
not all the time, though.
Okay, well, let me finish. When the dolphins swim in between those bioluminescent creatures, you can see their outline under the water, you know, as a shadow. So it shows like an outline of them. It's very, very cool. I don't know if you've ever seen that. So you're not seeing the dolphin, but they're just kind of covering up those bioluminescent
organisms. Oh, yeah. Do they ever have that phenomenon in Hawaii? We actually had that here last year. It was the one cool thing about COVID was, you know, sneaking down to the beach during lockdown to go see the bioluminescent organisms in the water. And the water just lightened up like a glow stick.
Nice. What was that at like Long Beach or San Diego kind of area?
Yep, Long Beach. Yep.
Nice. Yeah.
So do you ever get back to Pasadena?
I do. Yeah, I was just there in September. So I was home for August, last month. So I went to the Denver Outdoor Retailer Show for my business. So I went to the Expo Center. So I went back home, picked up a whole bunch of books and did a road trip to Denver.
You know, Hawaii is beautiful, and I don't need to tell you.
Will you keep talking over him?
I'm sorry. Hawaii is beautiful, but it's so freaking expensive. I mean, when you go to Safeway, you're paying 25 to 30, almost 30% more.
Yeah.
Than They're Safeway. On a freaking island. How are they supposed to get their stuff?
I get it. Even Costco is a little bit more expensive. It's not too bad. Yeah. But
again, an island.
Hey, they have Whole Foods now. I'm very proud of you. It's kind of tucked away in, you know, up there in this, by the Maui Mall, I think. But
yeah.
At least they got that there.
There's like Target now, too. So
yeah.
Target?
Yeah.
It's wow. A huge Target. It's huge.
Where's Target?
By the airport.
Right across the street from Walmart.
Yeah.
Oh, by the street from Walmart.
Yeah. That's pretty funny.
Well, that's...
Yes, so go ahead, Shay. Thank you so much for your time. This was awesome. Yes. We hope to see you in January. Go ahead, plug all your stuff again. Where can we get your books, order your books, Instagram, whatever, other social media, which I know we're definitely following you on Instagram.
Do you put out a newsletter or something, Shay?
Every once in a while, I'll do like a newsletter when I get new books or new products coming in. So I have like bamboo shirts and whenever I have new books coming in, kind of give out emails.
Okay.
So yeah, you can.
How about a man's shirt? You got women's Razorback Tank Black. You got the bamboo women's Razorback.
Yeah.
Blue,
well, maybe you should just wear a woman's t-shirt.
Yeah. So I pretty much sold out t-shirts. So I have men's sleeveless now.
Okay.
So like
he needs sleeves. He's a white. He needs sleeves.
Yeah.
No, summertime. I'm going.
Or I guess it's getting a little bit cooler now. It's always summer here.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Summer. But you know what was interesting, Shay? It wasn't very humid or hot when we were there in August. It was kind of very pleasant. I thought it was going to be like super hot and humid. So I don't know if it was something to do with all the smoke from California getting out there and blocking the sun or what. But
yeah.
Usually the smoke blows to the east. Also, the island looks very dry. When you look up in the hills, by Iowa Needle up there in that part of going up from Kihei going to Maui, mm-hmm. Those mountains are very brown. I've not seen them as brown as they are now. Are you getting the right rainfall?
Not as much. It's been really dry. It's definitely been dry lately. And that has to be impacting the environment. You have the trade winds coming through, so that kind of keeps the humidity really like settled. Ah. Yeah. That makes it nice.
Where does Maui get its water from? Is it coming out of the mountains?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like Iao Valley.
Okay. Yeah. And are you guys in a drought right now, or are you okay water-wise?
No, they're trying to tell people to like not water their lawns or wash their cars and stuff like that. So it's kind of, yeah, we're definitely kind of in a drought.
Okay. We're in the Southwest here, California, as you know, Nevada.
It's been many years,
and Nevada Lake Mead is.
He's from California. He knows.
I know. He knows the drill. But it's not just California. It's Arizona. It's Nevada.
Well, maybe you people shouldn't live in the desert. I don't know.
Well, California's a desert. What do you think?
Also true. Yeah. So yeah, plug your stuff. Where can we find you? Social media, website.
Yeah. So it's my Instagram's Advanced Wildlife Education. Yeah, I'm always posting like different wildlife facts, information about all different kinds of species. My website's advancedwildlifeeducation.org.
Yeah, so Facebook is.
Okay. Well, we certainly appreciate you spending the time with us.
Yeah, definitely.
And it was just fortuitous or serendipitous that I met him over there at the mall thing. I didn't buy anything from you at that time. I'm sorry. But now that I know what you have.
Yeah.
You know, make sure you have some men's t-shirts. Can you do some tie-dye? I really am into tie-dye.
Can you leave this poor man alone and stop telling him what to do?
No, I'm going to tell him what's going
to
sell.
No, you stop telling him what to...
A tie-dye with a shark or a turtle on it. Yes.
Shay, you can ignore him.
I have the turtle
now.
The whale's going to be the next design.
Okay, fine.
But what tie-dye colors were you...
Whatever tie-dye, like blue, red, yellow, all that stuff. Just do the... I bought a beautiful tie-dye shirt from a lady at that festival.
Yeah, keep telling him how you bought other stuff, but not his. That's great.
When we go back, we're going to see you, and we're buying books from you and the shirts. Definitely. Okay.
Yeah. Spot 320.
And you're going to...
And then we'll also bring you one of those ice pops, the lemonade strawberry one from that vendor over there. Yeah. Pretty good.
I know, it's tough. Little... I'm right across from the Shave Ice Girl, so always watching people all day eating Shave Ice. So.
Right. It's not good for your teeth.
Yeah.
Okay. But Jesus.
Anyway, thank you, Shay. We do appreciate the time you spent with us.
Thank you so much, Shay. And we hope to see you in January.
See you in January.
We will see you in January, and we will buy out your entire booth.
Yeah, there you go.
Early day.
All right. Now that's getting a little crazy there.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shay. Have a great evening. Have a great rest of your day.
Mahalo.